Excuse me. The mic's on there.
Oh, come on.
Just project your voice if it's not working.
This is just a power switch.
Yeah, you can use this. Yeah, use the mic.
Thanks.
It's supposed to be a bit louder.
Yeah.
Good afternoon, everyone. Okay, so today we're just two students who have built a submarine. I'm Daniel, this is Michael. Have fun reading the descriptions.
Okay, speak a bit more.
Okay, so why do we build the submarine in the first place? Is it for the greater good of humanity? Is it for the joy of discovery? No. We were signed up by a friend. And I guess in the end, we found it pretty interesting and cool. So yeah, maybe Stockholm syndrome, maybe it's not. Who knows? But what's so difficult about building AUVs, right? Isn't it just an underwater UAV that you have to change the name because otherwise it's too similar? No. It's not. Waterproofing is not difficult. You can just seal everything in silicone, use gaskets. The thing is, the sensors and thrusters that you need to be in the water, because that's your medium. And like, you need to interact with the medium, right? And reliable, efficient pass-throughs are difficult. And the other thing is that buoyancy is surprisingly difficult to estimate. Sure, you have this fancy equation, which is very fancy indeed, but just as in building a drone, the problem is not about like how heavy it is or how floaty it is, it's about finding the center of gravity, or the center of buoyancy in this case. So, I don't know how many of you have built drones here, how many have no idea, but with a drone, all you need to do is balance it on something and see where gravity takes it. The thing about a submarine is that in water, the buoyancy of the thing, especially when it's filled up with a lot of air, like when you use a sealed hull, the buoyancy outweighs gravity. So you have to waterproof it, dump it in the water, and then balance it from there, which is very hard, and especially if you don't have a giant body of water. So yeah, first AUV ended up unbalanced. And proof, case in point, look at this. Not very balanced at all. Yeah, so as you can see, we have many design issues from their experience. Building drones is pretty common, but submarines are first time for us at least. Sensitive buoyancy off center, exposed cables, and who wants chemistry demonstration? Look at this. Guess what happens? Okay, as it's electrolysis, the one on the right has salt deposits from electrolyzing the water. Very fun. And that's a programming thing. Our image recognition didn't work, but we fixed it because no programming. Where are we now?
Okay, so where are we now? So this is Magni. This is a new AUV that built from the ground up. Seeing that the whole can you guys hear me without the mic? I'm not using the mic. Can I? Okay, so we built from the ground up after realizing that the old AUV was not exactly sufficient. It couldn't turn well. It had issues in terms of its maneuverability. So here we experiment with something completely new. Most AUVs, as we know, ship a torpedo with just a fin at the end, so it can move up, down, left, right. This is great for wide open operations in the ocean because you're not really writing down anything. So what happens when you want to take it down to fragile things such as coral? Well, you need maneuverability. So thinking like an underwater helicopter, it's like to make these vector thrusters. As you can see, they're actually able to tilt. This allows us to achieve drone-like maneuverability. But because water is quite viscous, we can simply tilt the vehicle to make it move in any direction we want. Design studio and engineering facilities invented by a unique voice system invented by one of our seniors. Then,
makes sense.
Okay, so the advice to making this AUV were quite arduous indeed. So because we're students, we have limited time. This means that after finishing our homework, we usually have to stay up at night to test. And because NUS has a pool, as I'll show you later, we actually had to test by this right near the pond with a right near the field. Instead of the pond, we had to use a large plastic box to contain our UV. This was taken at 11 p.m. at night because we really, really had no time. Yeah. And as you can see here, sometimes you get kicked out of the lab because you work way too late. This is Daniel applying heat shrink in the stairwell because it was too windy upstairs. So, as you can see, although we should be working the same in the lab, sometimes our interest is simply cannot be held back. So, again, we couldn't test it. We had no pod, we had no pool, we had to test in school in near the field. Surprisingly, it worked out quite well, although I don't have footage for this. So, we're sharing this not so much because our product is revolutionary, it employs high-tech solutions, but rather because I want to make a point. The point being that making is not simply working a lab all day and coming up with a final product. It's the journey. Makers follow their interests and do what others won't. Making can be done anywhere, anytime. As you saw, we were on the field, somewhere with no tools, and we managed to find a wall socket, plug in our soldering iron, and get this thing done in the middle of the night, on a school night. So as long as you have the passion, and as long as you have the time, making can be done. We are two announced 18-year-old students, and we've done something that most uni students have not done. So with that, I would like to thank you for just listening to this quick presentation. Do stop by our booth downstairs if you'd like to know the more technical details of this. And if we have a bit of time, sorry, how much do we have?
2 minutes.
Okay, is there any questions I can probably fill with one or two?
Nope, have fun, okay.
Do you have any questions?
Sorry?
Do you have any questions you want to send
in? Okay, so as you mentioned earlier on, this was actually designed for SUVC, the Singapore Autonomous Underwater Vehicle Competition. It's a competition targeted at uni-level students whereby you have four main tasks. Number one, to deploy a ball of your choice into a colored bin. Number two, image recognition. This comes in two parts. As you launch your vehicle, as you switch your gate with a green ball on the left and a red ball on the right, in that exact orientation. The third, the second part of the image recognition is to actually find the colored bucket you have to deposit your ball in. There are four buckets, three blue, one red. You have to deposit the red one for maximum points.
Oh,
finally, it's retrieval. We have to pick up the ball from...
Completely autonomous.
Huh?
Completely autonomous.
I'll say it later. It's there. Yeah, so basically, we have to also collect the ball that we deposited earlier on. And the big catch about this is that it is completely autonomous. So that means we have to have all our sensors in the one box. Sadly,